So, good morning and welcome to Cambridge. Cambridge University is this interesting mix of history and high science. And we're going to try and show you a flavour of both of those. This morning we're mainly going to focus on the high science, and this afternoon we'll be mainly on the history. The university's been here for just a little over 800 years. And yet it's still one of the world's premier universities. In all league tables I've ever seen, it's in the top 10, usually in the top 5, up there with Stanford and MIT and the big American universities. But it's got 800 years of history. For me personally, this is quite a nostalgic moment, because almost exactly 40 years ago, I was sitting where you are now. My very first lecture as an undergraduate in this great university was in this very lecture theatre. So it's a nostalgic moment for me personally. But what I'd like to do over the next few minutes is to give you some background to SKF and technology, but I felt I couldn't start here in Cambridge without saying, oh, I have a problem, first problem of the day. I felt I couldn't start here without just saying, telling you about a few of the great things that have happened, more or less right here, within a few hundred meters of this lecture theatre. So I'll spend a little bit of time on some of the greats of history, and then I'll move on and talk about SKF. We style ourselves in SKF as the knowledge engineering company, and I'd like to just explain a little bit about what that means. Then I want to focus on our research and development that we do in SKF. Then some of the real core skills, core competences we have, and one of those is very definitely on steel and the way that you get the best out of steel. And that really leads to a lot of our new product developments and has led us to establishing the first of our university technology centres here. We are supporting across the world 5 large university technology centres, but this one, Cambridge, is our first one and still our most important one. So I'd like to cover the context of what we're doing. Okay, so let me start with some science. Let me start with some history of science. I guess if you asked anybody to think of a scientist, you'd probably either come up with Einstein or Newton. There's probably a third. If you asked a scientist that question, you might come up with a third one, Clark Maxwell. But most people would rate those three probably as the greats of the last 1,000 years in science. Well, Isaac Newton was here. Isaac Newton was the Lucasian professor of mathematics here. Science didn't really exist in Newton's day. He was professor of mathematics here, and in many ways he sort of invented the science that some of us loved or hated at school. Invented the laws of motion, came up with those fundamental laws of motion. In doing so, invented calculus, or invented part of calculus, integral calculus. He developed the universal law of gravity, this thing that causes the moon to rotate around the Earth, or the Earth to rotate around the Sun. It was Newton that came up with this equation that explained why it should do that and how it should do that. In order to do that, he constructed a new kind of telescope. He invented and made the reflecting telescope. And he did a whole lot of things on light and colour and so on as well. So really one of the absolute greats of science. We're going to have dinner tonight in St. John's College. Isaac Newton was the master of Trinity College, which is the college right next door to it. We'll go past that on the punts later on today. Then I talked about Maxwell. Those of you who did science at university, I'm sure, learned Maxwell's equations. Again, you either loved them or hated them, depending on how good you were at mathematics. I must confess, they weren't my favorite subject. But this guy really did unite the whole field of electricity, magnetism, electromagnetic theory. Again, really one of the absolute greats of all time of science. He did his work in the Cavendish laboratories, which literally are, well, we'll walk through them today. We're going to go and see the Maxwell Lecture Theatre, where this man lectured to his students. You wouldn't want to have been there. They deliberately designed the lecture theatre to be as uncomfortable as possible so that the students didn't fall asleep. I hope you won't fall asleep today, but I hope at least the lecture theatre here is a little more comfortable. Then maybe my own hero, J.J. Thomson. Why is he my hero? Why is a Scotsman? Like myself, like Tom, he came... He came from Scotland. And this was the guy who discovered the first subatomic particle. I guess you've all heard of electrons, even those of you that aren't scientists. It's one of the kind of real base subatomic particles taught in very early stages of science across the world. This was the first man ever to prove that there were such things as subatomic particles and to prove that every element had the same subatomic particles. And that really was quite a major breakthrough. And he won one of the world's first ever Nobel Prizes. You may wonder why Newton and Clark Maxwell didn't win their Nobel Prizes. Well, they were before Nobel, so they didn't have the opportunity to win a Nobel Prize. But this guy won one of the first Nobel Prizes. And indeed, this university, I believe, has won more Nobel Prizes than any other organization in the world. The Nobel Prize has been around for a little over 100 years, and this university has won 88 Nobel Prizes, or is 88 Nobel Prize winners. Now, admittedly, there's more than one Nobel Prize each year, and there's sometimes given to more than one person in each area, but it's still a density of Nobel Prizes unrivaled anywhere else. And then another name that I'm sure you may have heard of, Rutherford. Ernest Rutherford, credited with splitting the atom. It's not actually quite true that he split the atom. Actually, two of his associates who also worked here, Cockcroft and Walton, actually split the atom, but Rutherford's the one that everybody always remembers. He was the head of the department. He was the one that got all the credit. The real kind of father of nuclear physics. Oh, I'm a fan of Cockcroft particularly because he was at St. John's College where I was, but Rutherford's the name everybody remembers. And Rutherford undoubtedly changed the world in the understanding again of subatomic particles that led to the whole of nuclear science and nuclear engineering. And again, Rutherford did his work, Cockcroft Walton did their work within a few hundred meters of where you're sitting now in the Cavendish Laboratories in Cambridge. And then the final one I'd like to talk about, Crick and Watson. Crick and Watson discovered the structure of DNA. More recent one, well, not long actually before I came to this university. I don't know if many of you spotted, just before you turned up the steps to come up to this lecture theatre, there was a thing that in my day, when I was here in Cambridge, were the cycle sheds. A funny little sort of wooden shed. It's now the Rolls-Royce University Technology Centre here in the materials department. But in my day, it was the bicycle sheds, and I never looked twice at it. And it actually was only about 5 years ago that somebody told me those bicycle sheds, now the Rolls-Royce Cambridge University Technology Centre, that was where Crick and Watson discovered the structure of DNA. And I find it staggering that to this day, there is still no notice on the side of it to explain that this is where Crick and Watson did this work, because this is the whole basis of modern genetics. You know, without DNA, without understanding how DNA reproduces itself and so on, you really don't get into genome theories and genetics and any of that. So I don't want to labour the point of quite how great this little area has been in the past, but it really quite dramatically has set the framework of world science. And we're going to see some of that. I hope we're going to look at lots of the cycle sheds or the University Technology Centre on the way past and see Maxwell Theatre and so on on the way past. So we're going to look this morning, when we go around in our tour, we're going to look at a very interesting, I hope, mix of real high tech. You'll see some of the world's most advanced electron microscopes and some real history of where it all happened. And then this afternoon we'll look at some of the older history, some dating back more of the 800 years throughout the history of what's happened here in the past. So let me move on then and talk about SKF. SKF, the knowledge engineering company. What is a knowledge engineering company? What does that mean? Well, our group vision is to equip the world with SKF knowledge. And I remember when I joined SKF 5 years ago, I remember thinking, I don't understand what that means. Does that mean we give away all our knowledge? Does that mean that how on earth do we maintain our position if all the time we're teaching everybody what we do? And I found it really quite confusing. And I found as I got into SKF, and as I got underneath the skin of SKF, I really discovered what it meant. And I've translated it for me and for the technical people that work for me. Of what does this vision really mean for us in terms of technology? And what it really means is we've got to provide our customers with real value through our technical knowledge. We're probably not the lowest cost producer. You probably can buy lower cost bearing seals, whatever, from other people. It's our aim to be the best. It's our aim to build value into that product through the use of our knowledge. And for me and for the technical people that work for me, that means that maintaining our technology leadership is absolutely critical. I remember when I joined the company, I joined it just a few weeks after our 100th anniversary, and I remember Tom saying to me, "Alan, we've created every major breakthrough in bearings in the last 100 years. It's your job to make sure we do it for the next 100 years." And I thought, well, thanks, Tom. But what a challenge and what an opportunity. And what an exciting job to be the guy in charge of technology. So I want to share a bit of that with you over the next half hour or so. Excuse me. SKF, very much known as a bearings company. The world's leading manufacturer of bearings. But we see ourselves very much as having five technology platforms. They're all very related. They all really support our activity in bearings. The bearings guys will tell you bearings never wear out. The real, true bearings people will tell you a bearing never fails. It's really the lubrication that fails. In a rolling element bearing, the ball or the roller rolls round against a steel ring. And if it's working properly, it should trap a thin film of oil between the ball and the ring. And the two steel surfaces should never touch. That very, very thin layer of oil or grease should separate the steel at all times. And provided the two steel surfaces never touch, they can never wear out. It's not quite true, but it's almost true. You do still transmit loads, so other things can happen, but it's almost true. So the true bearing expert will tell you, bearings never fail, it's this guy that's wrong. But the lubricant fails. If you lose that lubrication film when steel touches steel, then yeah, you start doing damage to the bearing. So through that, SKF has become really pretty expert at lubrication. And as a result of that, we've both developed and acquired companies that manufacture lubrication systems, that put the right amount of grease in the right place at the right time. We're the world leaders in lubrication systems, but very much in support of our activity in bearings. Now, the lubricant guys will tell you, do you know, the lubrication never fails. What fails is this thing, the seal. The seal fails, the lubricant drips out, and then the bearing fails. Again, an oversimplification, but there is some truth behind it as well. So as a result of that, we've made ourselves sealing experts. We make a lot of our own seals. We sell seals to other people as well, but we make a lot of our own seals. Mechatronics, that's a word that means different things to different people. So for us, what it really, I think, means is combining our knowledge of mechanics and of electronics. We're seen as one of the world's foremost precision mechanical engineering companies. We machine very hard steel to very high tolerances, faster and better than anybody else. We're not so widely known for our electronics knowledge. I was astonished when I joined SKF to discover that SKF made 5% of the world's fly-by-wire systems. Fly-by-wire systems are the systems that control the world's latest aircraft, either military aircraft or now civil aircraft. Very, very complicated electronic systems. We make 5% of them. Gosh. Mechatronics for me means taking that electronics knowledge and adding it to our mechanical engineering knowledge. And you'll see from some of the examples I give later how we're beginning to put that together in some really clever and some really pretty sophisticated ways, but in ways that really could change the way we think about bearings and how they operate. And then finally, services. We provide this clever mechatronics often in the form of condition monitoring, of telling you what's happening within the bearing or within the mechanical system. And once you're able to measure that, well, it makes a lot of sense to offer that as a service to the customer. The customer often doesn't want to do that themselves. They often just want to know when things are going wrong. Don't bother telling me when everything's perfect. Just give me a call when it starts going wrong so I can do something about it. And we provide that as a service. So SKF is active and developing technology, not just in bearings, but in all of those areas. It's really all about managing and reducing friction for the customer. So, a few words about our research and development. First of all, what do we spend? Well, we're spending at an ever-increasing rate. When Tom told me he wanted us to stay at the forefront for the next 100 years, I said, that's great, Tom. Your side of the bargain is you've got to back me and give me the money to spend. And he promised he would. And damn it, he has. And I have never worked for a chief executive before that is so committed to the future and so committed to technology. Life as the head of technology is an absolute dream when you've got a boss that's willing to back your ideas. It's not so much fun if he's not, but Tom, I have to say, has backed everything I've put in front of him. As you can see, I've had pretty significant increases in budget every year. The one exception, of course, 2009, when I guess we all had our share of problems. At one point, SKF manufacturing was down by over 25%. Our sales were down nearly as much. And Tom's instruction to me, don't get rid of a single engineer or scientist. I haven't worked for a company before that would have said that to me in such a downturn. So we have a very strong commitment to technology. What are we spending this money on? Well, this is actually a slide that Tom showed our investors recently when we announced our last set of results. So these are actually Tom's priorities rather than mine. Obviously, he talked to me before he did it, but these are Tom's priorities. Environment. We are very driven by environmental issues, environmental concerns, environmental opportunities. We very much see the environment as an opportunity rather than a problem. We have a big contribution that we can make in order to help our customers reduce friction, reduce their energy bills, reduce CO2. We are very focused as well on doing that ourselves within our own operations. We're focusing on core technologies, I'll come back to those later. Focusing on some new products, again, I'll come back to that later. Strengthening our R&D in fast-growing regions. We are setting up large new research laboratories at the moment in both India and China. And this last one, and this is Tom's slide, remember, for the investment community. Strengthening our links with universities. And I guess that's one of the reasons we're here today. So, where are our major facilities around the world? I could have put more of the yellow dots. There's product development done in an even wider range, but these are the principal ones. Our major research facilities in Sweden, manufacturing development, in Holland, technology development, new laboratories in India and China, and a technical center in North America. And then the green ones show the university technology centers, and we are here today. This one here is Cambridge. So there's one also in London, one in Gothenburg, one in Luleå, and one just outside Beijing in China. So those are the principal places where we do technology around the world. This is our Dutch facility. We've been in this facility for about 40 years. Everybody always asks, why is a Swedish company with lots of international activities, why do we have our research center in Holland? Well, it was set up there before I ever joined the company, so it's difficult for me to know the real truth behind this. The story that goes around is that the Swedes wanted to have it in Sweden. The Germans wanted to have it in Germany. SKF France wanted to have it in France. SKF Italy wanted it in Italy, and so on and so on. And the chief executive said, where don't we have anything? And we didn't at the time have anything in Holland. And so we put our research center in Holland. I don't know how true that is, but it actually gives us some really big advantages. It's seen as completely neutral from within the rest of the company. It's an easy place to get to. It's quite close to Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam. It's quite easy to fly into from anywhere in the world. And we have a very, very international flavor about this research center. We have over 25 nationalities working together in this research center. Normally within a research center, it's very difficult to get the different departments to talk to each other. So if you have a metals department and a computer department and a plastics department and a measurement department or whatever, they all normally sit at lunch in their own departments and talk to themselves. Not here. Here, all the Italians gather together at a table, and all the French gather together at a table, and all the Germans gather together at a table, and we get this networking happening automatically. And it's a real plus, it's a real advantage. I have never seen a research center so well networked as this research center in Holland. This is our research center in China, or will be our research center in China. It's still a computer-generated graphic at the moment. We're currently employing 70 people, and we're renting a building at the moment while we build this one. We have the land now. We start the building work in September. I said it's 70 right now. It will be 400 people by 2015. That's the plan. India, we really have the building. The building was opened by Tom in December last year. Again, similar ambitions, 400 by 2015. We have 140 there today. It's a little bit ahead of the Chinese one. We started it about a year earlier. So those two big new major technology facilities in the growing and rapidly developing regions of the world for us. A very strong commitment to work with customers in those areas. Very strong commitment to develop and expand our technology activities in those regions of the world. So let me talk about what are the core technologies. What are the things that really, really, really matter to us and make us the companies that we are today? Well, every time I list our real needs, our real requirements, I come back to steel. SKF used to own its own steel company, Ovako, and we sold Ovako, I think, about 8 years ago now. It was the right thing to do strategically. It was very difficult to work with any other steel company. When you own your own steel company, nobody else would do development with you. So for good strategic reasons, we decided to sell Ovako. It's been a very clever commercial decision. From a technology point of view, it's enabled us to work with other steel companies, but we did lose a lot of our steel technology and steel knowledge within SKF. And one of my core goals, key goals the day I joined this company, was to rebuild our steel knowledge and put us right back up there at the top of understanding bearing steels in particular. And that's very much where this University Technology Center that we're visiting this morning plays a critical part in our steel technology. We've also increased the number of people at our research centers, both in Holland and in manufacturing development in Sweden with steel technology. So heat treatment is the way that you get the best out of steel. Steel is an interesting material, and I'm going to let Harry, our professor here, talk to you more about that later. But what you do to steel after you've formed it, how you heat it, cool it, bash it around, makes an enormous difference to its properties. So that's what I mean by heat treatment. So steel, absolutely critical to us. When I was sitting where you are now, whatever, 39, 38 years ago, learning metallurgy at this great university, I was told that the maximum strength you could get out of steel was 2 gigapascals. Don't worry about the units, it was 2. And I was told that was closer to the theoretical strength of the material than any other material. The theoretical strength of steel should be about 20, but you can never get there. For real practical reasons, but 2 was closer than you could get to the theoretical strength than any other material. SKF, 2 is nothing for what we put into bearings today. Typically it's 4 if it's a highly stressed bearing. I've seen numbers of 8. I wouldn't have believed that. My lecturers wouldn't have believed that when I was sitting here 40 years ago. So steel and the way we handle steel and the way we treat steel is critical to SKF. Other materials are important as well. The one I'm flagging up or highlighting here is ceramic materials. For our very highest loaded bearings, we actually change the rolling elements from being steel to to being a very hard ceramic material called silicon nitride. And silicon nitride does actually outperform steel, and especially silicon nitride rubbing against steel rings on the inner surface here performs extremely well. So our very highest loaded bearings are actually in silicon nitride, in a ceramic material. So material science generally is critical to us. Sensorization, this mechatronics bit, this adding functionality to our bearings. This shows a bearing that has a sensor in it that detects the position that the bearing has stopped in. Why is that important? Well, this one is actually for Bosch. This is for what's called a starter alternator system for a car. In order to save or to increase fuel economy of cars, the latest generation of cars, when you stop the car, the engine stops. And then when you put your foot in the accelerator again, the engine automatically starts again and you drive forward. But it saves you using any fuel for that time when you stopped. And that saves, obviously, emissions and it saves fuel. But in order to get the car to start really smoothly, you actually fire it up on its starter motor first and start it moving forward on its starter motor before you switch on the spark plugs to fire the gasoline engine, the petrol engine that then takes you forward. And in order not to get a jolt as it transforms from one to the other, you need to know exactly where the car has stopped, what position the engine stopped in. And that's what this device does. SKF knowledge, enhancing the ability to create a new opportunity for fuel economy. Tribology, I hate this word. Tribology, what does it mean? It means understanding surfaces in a lot of detail. And I hate this slide as well. This slide looks like it's a really rough surface. It's a really rough surface until and unless you understand the units on this axis, which basically says there's about 50 to 60 atoms between the bottom of this surface and the top of this surface. So we're looking at this surface in a lot of detail is really the point I'm trying to make. And understanding surfaces in a lot of detail is really what's critical to the performance of a rolling element bearing. Modeling and simulation. We are by far the most advanced company in the world at understanding what goes on within a bearing, and indeed in modeling the situation that's happening around our bearings, so that we can understand the environment of the bearing and provide the right bearing to do the right job in the right application. Lubrication. I talked before about the stability, that you needed to have this very, very thin film of oil between the metallic elements, otherwise the bearing wouldn't last very long. So understanding what controls this thin film, what causes its degradation, how it forms, how it degrades, is absolutely critical to us. And sealing, one of our five big platforms. So understanding sealing materials, being able to design seals, being able to work with seals to provide the very, very best sealing function is absolutely critical. And then underpinning it all, a commitment to sustainability, a commitment to the environment. So those really are our eight core skills that we focus on in SKF. How do we use them? I just wanted to show one example. This one is getting a little old. We were 100 years old in 2007. And Tom wanted to have some major breakthrough to announce on the day of our 100th birthday. Unfortunately, he didn't think about this until about 18 months before. And he went to our chief scientist 18 months before and he said, Stathis, I want you to make the world's greatest breakthrough in bearing technology so I can announce it on whatever it was, 16th of February 2007. And Stathis said, well, that's pretty tough, Tom. How am I going to do that? And Tom says, oh, and I've decided what it's going to be, by the way. You're going to take 30% out of the friction of our bearings. And Stathis' first reaction was, Tom, our bearings are already far lower friction than anybody else. How on earth am I going to take another 30% out? And apparently Tom left him at that point and said, well, I'm sorry, Stathis, that's your job. I've got a company to run. Well, Stathis went off and thought about it. And he did it. And he did it in that time scale, and we launched the first two rings. We launched deep groove ball bearings and cylindrical roller bearings on the day of our anniversary, having done this in 18 months. And you say, I certainly said when I arrived, how on earth did you do that, Stathis? He said, well, a few things. I didn't cheat. I kept exactly the same external dimensions. I kept the same ISO load carrying standards. I had to make it exactly the same. But I used those core skills that we had in the company. So I first of all optimized the internal geometry. I opened up the osculation a bit crudely, if any of you are into the details of bearing. Broadly, if you've got a ball, it's running in a groove, and if you make the two exactly the same, you get colossal friction between the two. So you have to open up this groove a little bit, and the difference in the diameter between this one and this one basically is the osculation. Now, if you open it up too far, of course, the whole thing starts moving around and the whole thing gets a bit loose. But because our machining standards are higher than most, he was able to open up that osculation a little bit more than usual. We then changed the standard steel cage for a polymer cage. The cage is the thing that holds the balls or the rolling elements apart. You have to stop them from touching. Normally, this is with a steel cage. Here you can see a polymer cage. So our knowledge of non-metallic materials, our knowledge of polymeric material, enabled us to select and to choose and to validate a polymer cage to do that job, which we hadn't done before. And then perhaps more important of all, on because of our lubrication knowledge, we changed the grease. We went for a really special low-friction grease that we actually had developed ourselves. And those three things together took the friction down actually by more than 30%, but in true SKF fashion, we do 100 tests on 100 different kinds of bearings under 100 different kinds of conditions, and if the worst one's 30%, then we tell you that it's 30% better. Some of them, I can tell you, were over 80% better. And our range of energy-efficient bearings really is second to none that you can get anywhere else. I want to say a few words about our overall technology strategy, of where are we going, what are we doing for the future, what are our major new directions. Well, we see technology strategy in three different areas. If you think of somebody making an invention and of doing all the kind of early science that you need to do in order to find out if it's going to work, and then you start launching a product and you develop that product and it grows rapidly, and then you get into a volume part of the business. And to be honest, these aren't to scale. This, in our case, this volume business goes on for a long time. We do different kinds of research in each of those areas. For the volume business, what SKF is famous for is working with the customer to give the customer exactly what the customer wants in any application. And if you talk to our advanced customers doing difficult things, this is the thing they value SKF for most. We work with them, we get it right. It gives us an absolute nightmare from a production point of view. We have a far higher degree of product complexity than most of our competitors, but the customer really values it. And what we're really looking to do here is to be driven by the customer and to just fine-tune that product to do just what the customer wants it to do. In the rapid growth area, clearly, this is my challenge. This is me trying to create the next 100 years. This is we've got to make breakthroughs that really are driven by our knowledge, by our technology, leading to new product breakthroughs. And here's where Cambridge fits in. This early stage, this set the strategy, go in that direction. You need to stick with this for a while because it's going to take you time to get up this curve, but you get in early and you grab the intellectual property, the patents, and keep the competitors out. So that's how we think about technology. Let me just say a few words about what we're doing in each of those areas. Up at this end, if you look at the kind of late stages of this growth period, what I'm really looking to do is to bring all these together. If you just take us on bearings, other people make bearings, and they make bearings that look a bit like ours. I can really differentiate most easily by adding other bits to it, by adding an automatic lubrication system to the bearing, by adding a clever seal that takes a load of friction out the bearing, by adding some electronic functionality, by taking and combining all of these and offering the customer a bundling of our technologies is a real opportunity for us to develop more and quickly. At this end of the technology-driven invention scale, at the early stages, we have initiated a thing called the Innovation Board, And actually, it was initiated before I ever joined SKF. Tom had started it, although it wasn't working all that well. But it was one of the reasons I wanted to join SKF. If you read the textbooks on innovation, they all say one of the key things you must do is to engage the chief executive. Well, I found in SKF a company that already had the chief executive engaged. This innovation board is chaired by Tom Varton, myself, the three divisional presidents and the senior technical people are all on this innovation board. And we are looking for a small number of really big strategic projects that we're going to focus very large amounts of investment on. So the whole of the senior team are there. The key members of the senior team are there. My guys are always coming to me with a business case saying, I think we could do this. And I say, sorry guys, if it needs a business case to justify it, it's not good enough. This has got to be so blindingly obvious that it's right for SKF that I don't need a detailed business case to help me justify it to Tom. And they'll say, well, what do you want me to do? And I say, I don't know. I'll know when you show me it. I certainly know when Tom's going to accept it. He stops asking me what it's going to cost. He gets so excited about it, he stops asking about what it's going to cost. We just have to do it. And I'll show you some examples of the things we've been doing. It's got to be a real game-changing opportunity for us. It's got to be radical, but it's got to be absolutely blindingly obvious why SKF's doing this. So this is not rocket science, and I'll show you a few examples in a minute of the things we've been doing. And we're only looking to do 5 or 10, and these are maybe 5-year projects, so I'm only looking to find 1 or 2 new projects each year. I'm not looking for a very large number. I want to focus on a small number of real game-changing things. Here's one of them. You see the target? We'd done energy-efficient bearings. Stathis had done that and taken 30% out of the bearings. But, of course, most bearings that we sell are sealed. Bearings spin round beautifully when there's no seal in them. You put a seal in it, it just acts like a brake. Not much point in having really good energy-efficient bearings unless you've got really good energy-efficient seals. So, our seals were already state-of-the-art. Go on, how would it be if without any extra cost we could take 40% out of the friction of the seals? Seems kind of obvious thing to want to do. Dan Reed was running our sealing business at that stage. I don't think it took too much to convince Dan that this would be a good thing if we could manage to do this. You know, we could differentiate ourselves on this. Dan was really instrumental in getting this up and running with us. And here's where we are today. These, I won't go into the details of what they are, but this is the percentage improvement under various different conditions for various different temperatures and kinds of bearings and so on. And you can see that some of them are 60% better, some of them are only 20, 30% better. I think on average, we probably hit the 40 already. We still got work to do, but we are pretty much there. Of being able to offer low friction seals, and these will go into production quite soon. Here's another one. We make 1 in 4 wheel bearings for cars in the world. So we make as many wheel bearings as there are cars in the world, because most cars have 4 wheels. Sorry, for those of you less mathematical. Sorry, I didn't mean to. I was kind of obvious. Didn't mean that. I just wanted to explain what I meant there. So, if you could take, given that the car industry is trying to save weight, what could we do? Well, go on then. Set yourself a target. Take 30% out of the weight at no extra cost. Now, do you need a business plan for that? I don't think so. Where are we at the moment? We've got 30% out of the weight. We haven't quite got no extra cost. We're probably at about a 10% cost penalty at the moment. But that's okay for the early stages of this. That's okay for the luxury vehicles at the top end. This is important weight saving. It's weight saving in the unsprung mass, and it's rotating weight saving, which is all more important than static things within the car. And then advances in condition monitoring. We are the world leaders in condition monitoring. What do I mean by that? I mean by sensorizing the bearing, by listening to vibrations in the bearing, by measuring temperatures in the bearing, and using that as a way of predicting things that are going wrong with it. Our target here was to create a little band-aid, a little stick-on patch that stuck on the side of the bearing, that generated its own power, that talked to the internet, and then, oh, what is it you want to measure? You want to measure temperature, stress, vibration, oil condition. You know, you tell me what you want to measure, I'll put a sensor on there that'll measure it. And all you will know is you will have the data on the internet, and put it on your smartphone, put it on your computer, whatever. You will know the status of your bearing at any stage. And not just the bearing, if you're listening to vibration, it'll tell you about the whole vibration of the machinery around you. It'll tell you when you've got gearbox problems, it'll tell you when you've got pump problems, impeller problems, whatever. That's the concept. And we're pretty much there. It basically has got very, very clever power generating opportunities using essentially mobile phone technology to talk to the internet and some real clever novels on sensors. This is a Nautilus bearing, this is for windmill. You can see it's not quite as neat as a Band-Aid just yet, but this is the prototype. This one's for a railway application. We've hidden the bits within a lot of the existing parts of the system anyway. And it pretty much does what it says. Of course, the next thing we'd really like to do is tie this into our lifing model. What the customer really wants to know is what percentage of my life have I used up? And if I'm getting near the end, can I turn down the load in some way so that I can make it last a bit longer to get it into its next planned maintenance or whatever? But this is pretty much, these three that I've shown you are the only three I can talk about. These, as you can imagine, these projects are fairly sensitive within SKF. These are the three that we've talked to the outside world about so far. But I hope it gives you some flavor of the sorts of things that we're trying to do to make sure that we're still the premier company in bearings in 100 years' time. I'll finish this with a few words of introduction on our University Technology Center program. This fits in, as I was saying, at this end, at the strategy-driven direction end, at the very early fundamental stages of the development of any new area for us. We're really looking to underpin our own work with long-range work at the top science universities, science and engineering universities in the world. So creating clear core partnerships with some major universities. When I joined SKF, I saw that we spent an enormous amount of money in universities, but it was very scattered. We supported a PhD here, there, and everywhere. It wasn't working terribly well in many cases. Typically, I don't know, our Italian factory would want to start a PhD in their local university. And then often the person that had started the activity would move on to another job, and the poor guy doing the PhD that would be working away for 4 years or something, after 2 years our guy had moved on and he'd gone to America or something, and the PhD was sort of left behind, and there wasn't much lasting impact. I saw what Rolls-Royce had done in their use of universities. Rolls-Royce do an enormous amount of work with universities. They had this thing they called a university technology center. And as I say, the first one they ever did, nearly 30 years ago now, is actually on this site in high temperature material. They went in saying, I will support at least 5 people for at least 5 years. And I tell you, when you say that to a university, you suddenly get their attention. You don't just get talking to the lecturer level guy that's interested. The professor starts getting interested. And indeed, when we opened our university technology center here, the vice chancellor came along to join our opening and to say a few words. And the same when we've done that, all of our other ones, Imperial, Lulio, Chalmers, all the vice chancellors have all come along. But the Rolls-Royce model says, I fund 5 people. And then I'm going to go out and I'm going to look for partners. I'm going to look for customers or suppliers or people I want to work with. And I'm going to expect them to work with me on projects. So I'm going to try and find a person or a company or a number of companies, and they're going to support 5 people alongside me. So suddenly there's going to be 10 in this activity. And then I'm going to look for government funding. I'm going to look for either European Union funding or national government funding or whatever. And before you know where I am, I'm going to double it again. And I said to some of the senior people in Rolls-Royce that I've known for a long time, I said to them, what sort of multiplication factor do you get on your money? And they said, typically a factor of We tell everybody it's a factor of five. To be honest, I think it's a factor of four. And I said, that sounds pretty good. So you fund five and you end up with 20. And he said, yeah, that's about typical. So that's the model that we're trying to follow. It takes time to put in place, takes long-term commitment, but it really creates serious partnership, serious value between SKF and those universities that we're working with. So that's the goal of it. The goal is to get the university not doing the things that you would do anyway. This is not a cheap source of research. This is a partnership where the university are doing the things they're good at and we're continuing to do the things we're good at. But the two together really gives a major new opportunity for SKF. And the aim is to build long-term technology leadership. I said, you know, the aim was to do five people for 5 years. Here at Cambridge, I'll leave Harry and Pedro to give you the details of what we're doing here. But typically, the ones we've been working with for some time, Cambridge and London, we're already doubling the numbers of people that we're paying for. So alongside us are twice as many people as we're paying for, or overall, is twice as many people as we're paying for. And building partnerships with key customers and key suppliers. So we haven't got as far as Rolls-Royce yet. We haven't started getting the government funding in yet. We're working on that dimension of it, but we're certainly moving in that direction. Let me just say a little bit about each of those university technology centres and how they fit the core competences that I showed you earlier. I told you earlier we were working on these eight subjects. And where are we now with our University Technology Centre programme? Well, Cambridge here today, it's about steel and heat treatment. It's about providing the underpinning fundamental knowledge that we need to enhance and improve our steels. The one we have in China, in Tsinghua, is at the moment smaller than the others, but it's about sealing materials. It's about elastomeric materials that are for making seals. People at this point usually say, am I worried about intellectual property? Am I worried about leakage of knowledge in China? And my standard answer to that is, no, I'm not. I believe that although the Chinese have had a lot of press about, you know, stealing and ignoring patents, I believe the Chinese are changing very rapidly. I believe they will go exactly the same way as the Japanese went a generation ago. The Japanese used to be accused of copying everything and not respecting people's intellectual property. As soon as the Japanese started inventing their own things and filing their own patents, they started playing by world rules and now are an absolutely respected member of the international community playing by international standards and patents. And the Chinese are very, very rapidly moving that way. So yeah, this is a toe in the water. Yeah, I'm not doing anything really radical at the moment. A lot of the work we're doing at the moment is on analysing our competitors' materials and seeing how they respond to use and to ageing and so on. So I'm not yet generating a lot of intellectual property here, but I don't have any concerns moving forward in terms of will this be successful and can we work in China. Luleå, right up in the north of Sweden. There is where we're doing our work on developing completely new concepts for condition monitoring. So that's COMO, it's an abbreviation we use within the company. Condition monitoring and sensorization of our bearings. They've brought together three completely different departments that had never worked before together and have offered us some real insights that we would never have had ourselves in terms of how we can think about our condition monitoring business for the future. Imperial College in London, we are doing those real detailed understanding of what happens at that point of contact. What happens as you squash that oil film? How does that oil film break down or not break down? What are the conditions that you can use? How can you develop the right lubrication? How can you model it all? Because ultimately, you don't want to do everything experimentally. You want to have the fundamental knowledge, the fundamental understanding to enable you to do that. And then finally, Chalmers on sustainability and environment. We, as I say, have a very strong commitment to the environment. We have launched a whole range of energy efficient bearings. The payback on those energy efficient bearings for the customer can be very, very rapid indeed. If you're, for example, using one of our low friction bearings in a large motor application that's running 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, if it's for a big compressor for an oil company, a big pump of some sort, where the motor's running all the time, we charge a premium of between 20 and 30% for those bearings. The payback time on those bearings in terms of energy saving, the amount of power that you save, is about 2 weeks. Now, who doesn't want a 2 week payback? The work that we're doing in Chalmers is largely about developing that understanding and giving us the hard data to be able to sell to our customers the advantages of the products that we have to offer. So I'm going to hand over now to Harry. Professor Harry Bhadeshia, to give him his full title, is the director of our University Technology Centre. And our assistant director is up at the back, and we'll give a talk at the end. Dr. Pedro Rivera. We signed the contract for our University Technology Centre, I think, right at the end of 2008, and the work began in 2009. And I'm going to hand over to Harry to talk to you a bit about the background on steel, and then I think to Pedro to talk a little bit more about the work itself.
Do you have any questions for Alan?
Oh, I was hoping you weren't going to ask. I wasn't going to offer that opportunity. Go on, anybody like to ask me any questions? That's good. I can sit down. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, so today I'm going to talk about steel, but my focus over the last few days has been on gold. Yeah? I mean, I cannot concentrate on work, the rate at which gold medals are coming for Team GB. And, you know, if you compare against the major powers who have much larger populations, we are actually ahead of them. Yeah? Now, gold is, of course, very important. I don't know why, yeah, because it's technologically, it's a pretty useless material except in electronics for joining conductors and so on. And I want to show you that iron is what you should be excited about, okay? So let me start by asking you a question. Yeah, so feel free to shout out a question, an answer. Where does iron come from?
Ore.
Good, and any other answers? Okay, so I'm going to surprise you with the answer. Iron is made in the stars. Okay, so this is the Milky Way, it's our galaxy that we are in, and the Sun is approximately around here. And when the universe was created, the light elements like hydrogen, helium, they existed for billions of years. Okay? But the heavy elements are all made at extremely high temperatures where you force the nuclei to come together. And iron is actually made in the stars. Temperatures are of the order of 100 billion centigrade, and the pressures are enormous, and that's what makes iron. Furthermore, you know, I have to disagree with Alan when he said other materials are important. Iron is the most stable element in the universe. Okay? So this was calculated by a person called Fred Hoyle in Cambridge, who invented the term the Big Bang. You know, the Big Bang, the origin of the universe, he invented the term. But before that, he did extraordinary work on the stability of the elements. And he proved that iron is the most stable element in the universe. And eventually, you know, lowest energy state of the elements when the galaxy will completely become iron. Yeah? So if you're working on another material, you know, you're doomed. Right? So ultimately, everything will be iron. Now, he would have won a Nobel Prize for this work, but when he invented the term the Big Bang, he was actually being derisory. You know, he was trying to say this theory is no good. Yeah? And he tried to build and build an argument against the Big Bang theory and failed in the end. Okay. Can somebody now tell me what this picture represents? Crystals. Yeah, they're really beautiful to look at. But this is also a crystal. Okay, I'll pass it around. This is a single crystal. Okay? Have a feel. It's a turbine blade which goes into an aircraft engine where it experiences a temperature of something like 1400 degrees centigrade. And these are routinely made on the factory floor to enable very efficient aircraft engines to operate. The shape of that is nothing like the crystals that you saw on the slide earlier. Its shape is designed for aerodynamics. Okay? So the meaning of a crystal is not that it looks extremely nice and beautiful, but the scientific meaning of a crystal is that the atoms are arranged in a particular pattern which is repeatable over a long distance. So here, for example, is a crystal because the atoms are arranged in a regular order. In this case, the iron atoms are at the corners of a cube and at the center of the face. And we have some foreign atoms here, which might be carbon, to make steel. Steel is a combination of iron and carbon. So the scientific definition of a crystal is that we have a periodic pattern of atoms, okay? Not a random location of atoms as you might have in a liquid. So a crystal is defined by a periodic arrangement of atoms, and it was the two Braggs in Cambridge who discovered a way of interrogating materials to see whether they are crystalline or not by putting X-rays on them. And you will be visiting the laboratory where they actually did this Nobel Prize winning work. Now, these are the patterns in which iron atoms are arranged in solid iron. And the most common form of iron is where you have an atom of iron at the body center of the cube and at the corners of the cube. But if you heat the iron up, then this is how the arrangement changes. We now have atoms at the centers of the faces rather than in the middle of the cube. If you go right into the center of the Earth, where the temperature is of the order of 6,000 degrees centigrade and the pressure is enormous, then you have another form of iron, which is a hexagonal arrangement, and it's the densest form of iron possible. Okay. Now, these are just three different crystal structures of iron. There are actually seven different crystal structures which we can make, but the others are not very common. And of course, we can throw in many different elements into the iron. So here, for example, we have the carbon atoms sitting between the iron atoms, or we could substitute this with nickel or chromium or whatever. And there are hundreds and hundreds of different crystal structures that we can produce in iron. This bearing has countless billions of crystals in it. Countless billions of crystals. Okay? If you looked at this in a microscope, you would see the most incredibly beautiful crystals. I will show you some images later. But this is crystalline. Its shape doesn't resemble anything you would associate with a crystal, but this is crystalline. Now, the reason why we can use iron for many, many different applications is because we can change the structure by either deforming it or heating it. You saw some red hot iron in Alan's slides, putting magnetic fields, applying a stress. It is such a versatile material because of all these crystal structures that we can generate. This is the sound of crystal structure changing inside the iron. And this is the kind of sound that you might use in monitoring the condition of a bearing. And if you want, you can download this onto your mobile phone and use it as a ringtone. Okay? available on the internet. So this is the sound of crystals changing. And because we don't have a furnace here, I'm going to pass around another piece of metal, which is called indium. Okay? And if you bend it like this, you'll be able to hear changes in crystal structure. Okay? So pass this around. Okay, so it's the changes in crystal structure which tell us that we can make a vast variety of alloys with different properties. And the sound that you just heard, or the vibrations that you get when you get damage in bearings, is of course the condition monitoring that Alan was talking about, because when you install these windmills out in the oceans and so forth, you really want to stop the rotation at the point where you think there is significant damage, because you don't want the damage to grow and cause much bigger damage into the bearings. And all that has to do with the crystalline structure of the material. Now, this is just to show you that these crystal structure changes also cause a deformation. So here is a piece of metal. We are going from very cold to very hot. There's nothing, there's no components inside this piece of metal, and yet it's changing its shape. Yeah? Just by altering the temperature. So it's the fact that the patterns in which the atoms are arranged are changing, which produces that origami-like feature in the material. And now when it gets cold, it'll become flat again. So these changes in the order in which atoms are arranged are real. You can feel them. Yeah? And some of you might have seen advertisements for spectacle glasses made out of shape memory metal, so that if you bend them accidentally, you can just put a hairdryer and it'll come back into shape. Yeah? One day, cars might be made like that. Yeah? Now, this is the periodic table of the elements. And I explained to you that you will never actually find pure iron in any real application, because we want to engineer the material in order to provide the right properties. And we can add more or less anything that's on this periodic table, as long as it's not radioactive, into the metal and design new properties. And we can create solid solutions. So, you know, when we add sugar to tea, it dissolves, right? That's a liquid solution. Similarly, we can add elements into iron which dissolve into the solid iron and form solid solutions. And if we add a lot of that element, we might actually create new kinds of crystals inside the solid iron and therefore alter the properties again. So there is a huge amount that we can do. And you can do this in two different ways. One is what we call bucket chemistry. That means you just add and see what happens, right? But the possibilities are infinite, because you not only have a huge choice, but you also have different concentrations that you can add, and you could be there forever. Okay, that's not the way to go. So for many, many years, yeah, and I myself started working on iron in 1970, for many, many years, we have been developing the theory that enables us to predict what should happen. Okay, now, I don't want to get carried away and explain that we can do everything. That's just not true. The problem is incredibly complex. But we have developed sufficient theory for us to reduce the time scales in which we can get to a product. And then what we do is we express that theory in computer programs. Yeah, so this is just a way of telling the computer what to calculate. And this is one of my first ever students standing next to a supercomputer that we are using to do calculations. So by doing this, we can try experiments by calculation before actually spending a lot of money to do critical experiments, or even to take it to the next stage of development, which costs a huge amount of money. I mean, it wasn't long ago that I was at Alan's innovation board trying to get them to spend a huge amount of money to make a very large amount of material for bearings, a new material that we've designed. And I think it will happen. Yes. Yeah, This is a material that we created about 15 years ago. Okay, and it has two forms of iron in it. One is the body-centered cubic structure that you see here. And the other is the high-temperature form, which we've been able to preserve to room temperature. Okay, so we've got this beautiful mixture of two different kinds of crystals, an intimate mixture on the scale which is 1/1,000,000 of a meter in size. Okay, so this is 1/1,000,000 of a meter. Now, the finer you make the crystals, the stronger a material becomes, because then the atoms find it difficult to move across the boundaries between crystals. Okay? But even more important is that they become tougher, the material becomes tougher. That means if I hit it, it can absorb energy. So window glass, for example, is extremely strong. But if you hit it, it shatters. That means it doesn't absorb energy when it breaks. So we don't call it tough. The reason why we make cars out of metals is because they absorb a huge amount of energy should you have an accident. Yeah? So if you have an accident, you are protected, but your car basically is a write-off because it's designed to deform and absorb energy. So we want finer and finer crystals. And when we created this particular structure, we decided to apply it to a totally different kind of a railway line. Okay, so railway lines usually contain a phase which is called cementite, which is very hard but is not tough. So you can get easy fracture. Here we don't have any of that hard phase. We have these two beautiful and very fine crystalline phases. And in this image, you are looking at individual atoms. So we can go to magnifications where we can see individual atoms, and then we can color those atoms according to what kind of an atom it is, so whether it's carbon or iron. So here we are plotting the carbon as the red, and the green is the iron. So this is nothing fancy. These days we can do this routinely. But the point is that not only do we have two different kinds of crystal structures, but we also have two different chemical compositions. Okay, so one crystal absorbs iron, absorbs carbon more than the other. And that is why we've been able to retain that high temperature phase even to room temperature. Okay, normally the face-centered cubic form of iron is only stable at very high temperatures. Okay, so here is a real application of that particular structure. We can show that rolling contact fatigue is really good for this structure. Now, what is rolling contact fatigue? Alan explained that we've got a rolling element here, which turns around, and we've got a raceway. So when I turn this, every time this rolling element goes over the surface, it induces a stress underneath the surface. It's very large stress, you know, of the order of, I'll explain how big a stress it is. And it does that all the time the bearing is rotating. And eventually the metal fatigues, it gets tired, and it might break. But with this structure, because we don't have any hard particles, it's very good in rolling contact fatigue. And rolling contact fatigue is not just a problem of bearings, but also when a wheel goes over a rail. Yeah? And you can see that the new structure outperforms anything that existed before. And this is about wear resistance, and the wear rate is also reduced to a negligible level. And this is the new material in service in France. And have you been through the Channel Tunnel? Any of you been through the Channel Tunnel? So next time you go, remember me, because these are the rails that I designed which are in the Channel Tunnel. Okay? Yeah. Okay. Railway lines are strong and they are tough, but bearings are really strong, really, really strong. Okay? So this structure is no good for making a bearing. We've got to make it much, much stronger. Now, I explained to you where the strength comes from, so what should I do? What do I have to do to that structure to make it even stronger? Make it finer, yeah? So we know how to do that. Just to illustrate to you some scales first, I showed you a structure which was a millionth of a meter in size. Okay? Now I want to go to a structure which, in which the crystals are a billionth of a meter in size. Okay? So there are nine zeros here. Now we can do that by making the crystals grow in the solid iron at a much lower temperature. So we did some calculations on what is possible and what is not possible in a reasonable amount of time, because, you know, Alan might not want to do a heat treatment which takes 100 years. Yeah? Although, you know, you keep wine for 100 years, right? And then you sell it for much more money. Yeah. Now let me explain to you the meaning of strength. So, you know that Newton was in this university. Well, it turns out, you know, the weight of an apple is approximately a newton, right? So this is a scientific measure of weight. So an apple weighs a newton, and if I put it on 1 square meter, then the stress is called 1 pascal. Okay? Now, an ordinary steel would be able to support the weight of 200 million apples on 1 square meter. A bearing steel has to be able to support the weight of 3 billion apples on 1 square meter, okay? So probably you end up with just apple juice in those circumstances. So we are talking about very, very strong materials, incredibly strong materials. And if I look at this bearing again, and the stress is 2 gigapascals, that means 2 billion apples per square meter. And if it turns around at 25,000 revolutions per minute, and let's assume there are 20 balls here, then the total number of pulses of stress that the steel will experience is of the order of 500,000, half a million, in 1 minute. Okay? So imagine if you're being punched half a million times every minute, okay, with a stress which is 2 billion apples per square meter. Yeah, so the stuff that you are producing is absolutely remarkable. Yeah, and no one outside of here knows about that because it is beautifully designed. Yeah, it's a reliable material. It's not like your computer system, which has to have updates every so often. The fact that you don't know about it is a good thing because you don't need to know about it. Yeah? If it was unreliable, you would need to know about it. This is the structure that we are hoping will make the next generation of bearings, okay? So here we have reduced the scale of those crystals to 20 billionth of a meter in size. Yeah, so we still have two different kinds of crystals with different chemical compositions as well. And I don't know if you've heard about carbon nanotubes. Yeah? So these are very, very fine tubes of carbon which have had a lot of publicity but are not terribly useful. But we are finer now than carbon nanotubes. Okay? So this is an incredibly fine structure, and I want you to remember this image until dinner time. So there is a surprise for you, but I'm not going to tell you anything about it. So this structure is what we are hoping will lead to the development of a totally different kind of steel for bearings. The current bearing steels have what we call carbides. These are strong, hard particles, but brittle particles. Here we have none of that. We have these two beautiful crystals intertwined, producing the strength and indeed the toughness. And it's the same structure, but much finer as the rail steel. So I'm confident that we will have good rolling contact fatigue performance and wear performance. But we have to prove all that. Now, scientists have the tendency to make claims long before they are justified. Yeah? Long before they are justified. So if you look at, you know, papers from Nature and so on, they will claim that they are going to solve all the problems of the world, and a few years later, you know, they are of little consequence. Carbon nanotube story is like that. One of the reasons is that although in a laboratory we can make materials, when you scale it up, everything changes, absolutely everything. So one of the key requirements of anything that we do is we must be able to manufacture the material on a large scale in all three dimensions. That means you cannot use incredibly severe processing or incredibly rapid heat treatments, etc. And what I mean by large dimensions is that this is a photograph I took at the oil sands mines in Alberta in Canada. This is a huge truck, okay? But there's no magnification marker there. So just to put on a magnification marker, if you focus on the size of the wheel here, this is me, okay? So I want to be able to make materials which can be large in all dimensions and manufactured easily, hundreds and thousands of tons. And indeed, we have done that. So this, for example, is the best armor that you can buy, you know, to protect against really terrifying threats, made from the structure that I showed you earlier, the very fine crystals of 20 billionth of a meter in size. This is an aircraft engine for a civilian aircraft. And you may not know this, but most of the air actually doesn't go through the engine. It simply provides the thrust for the engine to push the aircraft forward. Only about 25% of the air goes through the engine and is burnt with fuel to cause everything to rotate. The critical component here is the steel shaft. Okay. And the reason why most of the air goes outside the engine is because you want to reduce the noise from the aircraft engine. That's why military aircraft are much more noisy than civil aircraft, because you can't afford in a military aircraft to have a very large engine. Yeah? Here you could have a couple of people standing in the opening. It's very, very large. So we want to make it even larger. And that means that the torque, the twist that you provide on the shaft is going to be even larger in the future. We are trying to develop this concept of that very fine crystalline state also for aircraft engine shafts. And you can see here, we can make them large, yeah? No problem at all. It takes 10 days to heat treat this, but we can make them large. And these are heat treatments being done in Germany. And this is the next stage. It's got to quite an exciting level. We have indications that this material will perform well, but we have a lot to do before something can go into a critical application. Now, I explained to you, this is just to illustrate some equipment that SKF has installed over here, so that we can actually do initial measurements of the rolling contact fatigue properties. This is Jihoon Kang, who is a PhD student working on this, and this is Pedro, who will talk immediately after me. Here we put our experimental materials, we subject them to contact stresses, rotate the system, and monitor the kind of damage that will happen in the material under the surface as we develop it. So this is just one of the set of experiments that we have to do to prove this material, and there are a lot more planned within SKF, you know, the manufacturing trials, et cetera, to do that. Now, I said to you that it takes 10 days to produce this structure. We are also working on making it faster, but that may not be an advantage if we are making large components. But I would like to get the structure even finer, even finer than 20 billionths of a meter. And our calculations tell us that we can do it, but it will take 100 years, okay? So we have produced this material, and one sample of it is in the Science Museum in London and one in my office. And at room temperature, we started this experiment in 2004, and it will be completed in 2104, yeah? So what I have to tell you is tell your children and your grandchildren about this story so that they can verify whether the experiment has worked or not. So the material has been polished completely flat. And if our calculations are correct, then by 2104, you will see surface upheavals on the piece of steel. And then my soul can rest in peace. Okay? Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer. The production part is the armor steel, you mean?
Yeah.
Production part is straightforward. There is no new technology in the production of the steel. The new thing is basically you have to transform at a low temperature, so almost like a pizza oven temperature. Whereas normal heat treatments for steels are done in furnaces and so on, this you have to hold at a temperature of around 200 degrees centigrade, and that is the key. That generates the very fine structure that we see.
How much can you reduce from the thickness from a normal steel to that steel to save weight and
right.
still give the same protection? And you can presumably have a huge...
Yeah. So in the case of armor, we have a parameter which we call the ballistic mass efficiency. That means if you take a standard armor, for the same ballistic performance, how much can you reduce the weight? And we are a factor of 3 times higher than standard armor.
Okay.
Yeah.
3 times.
Yeah. And that is now commercial.
So. That will save gasoline too.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So. Same
Okay, Pedro, do you want to come in? Pedro is the assistant director of the University Technology Center.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming and visiting us. I am the assistant director of research at the University Center. And, well, we started in 2009 with a number of projects. And I just want to give you a general flavor of what we're doing. And I would like to focus on what Alan mentioned was the intention of this group, which is to develop some of those seminal concepts that could later develop into technologies that lead to products that are better for SKF. And I will start my story with, just one regular bearing and what you actually want to avoid, which is failure. So. We, as you have seen earlier, failure originates from the contact between these rollers and the contact surfaces under big pressures. And as mentioned earlier, if you actually apply very large stresses, Harry mentioned, I think, 2 billion apples per square meter, this pressure we localize in very, very small areas, about 1 square millimeter. So even though what Alan has mentioned is correct, that lubricant in theory should be the key element or the key concept to look at, lubrication, it is the steel that fails. So what we want to do is to create something to avoid that failure. And there are many elements that are in the atmosphere that can actually diffuse and go into the bearing that actually produce failure. And hydrogen is one of those. Hydrogen, as you know, well, Harry mentioned that iron comes from the stars. And actually, if you look at the same Fred Hoyle's theory of universe formation, everything starts from hydrogen. So all the elements transmute from hydrogen into helium, and then you get to iron. Now, when we face reality, we have a bearing like this. This is the bearing surface that contains very fine grains, which are represented by these hexagonal bits. Those grains are usually about 1/100th of a millimeter. And then you have all sorts of features within those small crystals that we can call microstructural features. For example, Harry mentioned this brittle phase called cementite, which is everywhere in the microstructure. But hydrogen is one of these elements that is everywhere. Hydrogen is in the atmosphere, but most importantly, hydrogen is in the lubricant. So you certainly have heard that oil companies refer to this to oil as hydrocarbon molecules, because you are combining hydrogen with carbon, forming long chains. And what really happens is that when these bearings are subject to high pressures, sometimes those molecules that are in the lubricant just decompose and you get free hydrogen. And hydrogen is very tiny. Hydrogen is the first element in the periodic table that you saw today. And actually, it is very mobile and it diffuses in the microstructure and it produces damage. And that damage causes those failures that we saw in this earlier image. So one of the first projects that we started to work on in the University Technology Center is to devise a solution to prevent this hydrogen damage, which you see here schematically represented and leads to failure. So hydrogen is something real. It's not something theoretical. We, in the University Technology Center, we not only use state-of-the-art technologies to visualize the problem. For example, this is a three-dimensional atom probe. What this means is that what we are mapping here are atoms. Each of these small points are atoms. And this D stands for deuterium, which is a form of hydrogen. And this hydrogen is actually diffusing into the crystals, the small crystals that comprise this bearing, and produce the damage. So one way to prevent that damage is to actually immobilize those hydrogen atoms. And from the literature, we know that when we add this compound, which is titanium carbide, which are these small dots here, when we produce these small compounds, that locks the hydrogen. And this inhibits the damage that hydrogen can cause. So one of the contributions from the University Technology Center has been actually to devise, by Blanca Schuss, who is sitting at the end of the theater, one real bearing steel that contains these type of particles, which are titanium carbide-like, but in her case, she devised steel that is based on vanadium carbide. And we have proven that vanadium carbide actually inhibits the damage from hydrogen, and we have plenty of experimental evidence to do that. So actually, this technology has been filed and a patent has been requested. So that's one example of one of our two very first PhD students. Blanca is now considering whether she will join SKF, which was one of these long-term partnerships that Alan was mentioning. Our second first PhD student was Hansen Huang, who is sitting there at the end of the theater, who is also considering joining SKF as well, and who also worked in us in solving one of the seminal problems that also led to a patent request. And here, as you have heard from Harry, you can see a bearing, and these bearings contain these very complicated crystal arrangements inside them, and they are very carefully engineered. 1 millimeter is a unit measure that you are very familiar with, and the micron, as Harry mentioned, is 1/1000th of a millimeter. So this gives you, this is an optical image that you obtain from taking a portion of this bearing steel, cutting it, and polishing the surface. And this is about 1/150th of a millimeter, this line. And here you see these very fine needles that are arranged here and there. Now, these needles are the ones that result from a phase transformation. What Harry correctly mentioned is that one thing we would like to do is to create finer and finer crystal structures. For example, these are very long needles that are the result of this steel which sound you could hear that was slowly transforming and forming these needles that actually give the strength to the steel. But here it's important that you realize what is the size of this. This is a good-looking fellow that is showing that hair actually displays a thickness which is about 1/10 of a millimeter. That's 100 microns, 40 microns, 60 microns. People with very fine hair do have hair thickness in the range of 50 microns, which is about 1/20 of a millimeter. Now, when we design these new bearing steels that are very fine, Huang started taking as a reference this actual real bearing steel microstructure, which we call bainite, and this is what you see in some of these steels. And I want you to look at the scale marker, because this is pretty important. This is 0.5 microns, which is half a micron, which is 1/2000th of a millimeter. So this is about 100 times finer than your hair. And these are the scales that we are aiming for and that we actually realized, which is about 10 times. Actually, when you look at the thickness of these features of these small crystals, they are about 100 times finer than the usual bearing steel. Now, what is important here is that one of the shortcomings, so this is not new technology, as mentioned earlier. This is something that Harry had been working on for since 15, 20 years ago at least, or at least this type of development is from one, two decades ago. But what Huang did, which is breakthrough, is to devise a way to produce this crystal structure much faster and using less expensive elements. So, for example, one of the elements that in the original invention of this steel was considered is cobalt. And cobalt is rather expensive. What Huang has done is to demonstrate through thermodynamic calculations, through computer simulations, that we can actually produce this steel cheaper and faster. So we don't need to wait 100 years to go back to the British Museum to realize whether we form the microstructure. We don't need to wait 10 days. We're talking about a few hours to produce the same very fine crystal structure with more cheap elemental additions and possibly with better properties that we would realize soon. So to summarize, at the center of our research is our ability to produce bearings. We are doing research into fatigue, and this, in the case of Blanca, led to the conception of hydrogen-resistant steels. So we can prevent these damaging effects from this very fine atom, which is hydrogen, that really accelerates damage. In doing so, Rashid Bhatti, who is sitting towards the end of the theater, is using some of the finest characterization techniques that are available on Earth. You will see some of the finest electron microscopes towards the end of this day in the Maxwell, what the formerly Maxwell laboratory, where we have our high-resolution microscopes. This new knowledge is leading to new materials that could be commercialized, and most importantly, this would lead to the understanding so that we ensure that your products are reliable to your customers. Thank you very much.